Hi, I'm Alex with Splunk Education. In this video, we'll learn how to create macros, add arguments, and even create a nested macro.
Macros are really useful when you frequently run searches requiring similar or complicated search syntax. There are a couple of things that make macros stand apart from other knowledge objects in Splunk. Search macros are reusable portions of the Splunk search processing language, so they can be inserted into other searches or executed on their own. By default, search macros use the time range selected at search time, unless time modifiers are used, and allow you to define and validate arguments that can be passed to the macro's definition. Macros are used heavily in Splunk premium solutions, like Splunk Enterprise Security or Splunk IT Service Intelligence, as well as the Splunk Common Information Model. So it's important to understand how they work in case you need to troubleshoot them. As a best practice, if you do want to edit an existing macro that would impact one of the previously mentioned apps, we would recommend cloning it instead, making the necessary changes, and once you've confirmed it's successful, removing the old one. In this example, we have sales data from all over the world, but the team that needs it is located in the United States, so we'd like to display all currency in US dollars. To save our sales team some time from having to write the entire search, we can create a macro. We'll write a search using the stats command to sum up the total sales by product, and the eval command to append a dollar sign and add commas to our sales values. Now that we've verified our search works as intended, we'll navigate to Settings and select Advanced Search. Next to Search Macros, we will click the Add New action. We select or confirm the destination app and give our macro a name. The name should be something simple, but obvious as to what it does. We will name ours Total USD. Now to set our definition. This is the search string that will expand when the macro is referenced. Since we are starting our definition with a command, we will leave out the preceding pipe. This is to prevent the user from ever having two consecutive pipes in their search, which would cause an error. We'll click Save to create our macro. We are now ready to test out our macro. To use the macro, we need to surround the name with the backtick character. The backtick tells Splunk that this is a macro, and to replace it with the search in the macro definition. We will run this search over the last 30 days. Same results we saw before, but far fewer keystrokes. While creating the total USD macro has saved us some time, the goal should always be to make our macros as reusable as possible. Adding arguments to a macro is a great way of accomplishing this, since users can pass variables at search time that will help return the specific results they need. So let's create a variation of this macro, this time with arguments. We will follow similar steps as before, confirming the destination app and naming the macro. Let's call this one Total USD 2. When you plan to pass arguments to a macro at search time, you need to include the number of arguments, in parentheses, next to the macro name. We are going to change our definition to allow the stats command to take an argument for the function by adding the name of the argument surrounded by dollar signs. We will also add an argument after the as clause so the user can pass an appropriate field name. Then the eval command will format the new field values in US dollars. We add the argument's name to the arguments field and click Save. We can now test our macro by passing the average function and calling the field average sales. As you can see, it returns the values formatted in US currency. The macro can now be passed any revenue value you'd like to calculate. One thing to notice is that since we are using the toString function with the eval command, if we try to sort our results, they sort alphanumerically, which is not our intended result. Let's add one more argument that will allow the user to choose if they want to format the currency with eval or the field format command. Let's head back into settings, search macros, and clone the macro to add one more argument. First, we will want to adjust the name to TotalUSD3 to account for the additional argument. Then let's replace the eval command in our definition with an argument of CMD. We will add CMD to the arguments list in the order that the command will be passed to the macro. Splunk allows you to validate the arguments passed to the macro using an eval or Boolean expression. This is super helpful in cases where you would like to restrict an argument to a set or a type of values passed. We want to require that the command argument is either field format or eval. And if not, send the user an error. Just as before, within the macro definition, the arguments must also be surrounded by dollar signs within the expression. Last but not least is the validation error message. When you start including arguments to macros, you want to make sure to provide extra guidance to the end user in case the macro is executed incorrectly. As a best practice, make sure your message is inclusive of all arguments and validations. Now let's click Save and test out our new macro. Now when we search, we pass a command name as an argument as well as the value we would like to be displayed in US dollars. It is important to note the arguments must be passed in the order they appear in the definition. Using field format instead of eval, our results appear to be exactly the same, only now are able to be sorted numerically since field format only changes the appearance, not the underlying value. If we try to pass a non-valid command to the macro, we get a search parse error with a validation error message appended. Adding arguments to a macro is not where the possibilities end. Macros can also be nested within each other, meaning we can reference a macro within another macro's definition. Let's create a macro that will query the total revenue of a particular region our company sells products. We will name our macro APAC Sales. In the definition, we will search our vendor sales data. In our data, vendor IDs are assigned geographically, so setting the following range will define our APAC region. Then we will pipe to our original TotalUSD macro. TotalUSD is our inner macro, and APAC Sales is considered the outer macro. Since your inner macro will be contained within the outer macro, you will want to make sure you create your inner macro first. Let's click Save to continue and test out our nested macro. We type out the outer macro into the search bar, select the time range, and execute the search to see our total sales revenue for the APAC region. As you can imagine, understanding exactly what a macro is going to do would be helpful in many situations, especially when they are nested together. To preview what your expanded search string will resolve to, press the Command-Shift-E keys for Mac, or Control-Shift-E for PCs. While we cannot edit the SPL within the preview menu, we can click Open as New Search to launch a new tab and edit the SPL from there. Since macro definitions are nothing more than reusable portions of the search language, you can also use knowledge objects within them, including tags and event types. Our sales team would like to be able to easily search for failed online purchases from our website. Let's create an event type that will allow them to query these events. We search for the events, click Save As, and select Event Type. Let's give the event type a name and optionally tag it. We'll add a tag of web, select a color, and priority. Then click Save. To take this one step further, let's create a macro that will provide the sales team with a full statistical analysis for our lost web revenue. Now within the definition, we can leverage the existing event type for the base search. We will click Save once more and return to the home page to run our new macro. Since our macro has everything saved within the definition, all we need to do is type the name of the macro into the search bar, select a time range, and execute our search.
Thanks for joining us to learn more about using macros in Splunk. We suggest you check out the documentation, watch additional videos on the Splunk How-To channel, and register for courses from Splunk Education. Thanks for watching.